Well, hello and welcome to Outdoor Oklahoma. I'm Todd Craighead. Today I'm spending some time with State Game Warden Jacob Harriet. Now, our game wardens are a very special breed of law enforcement officers. Except on rare occasions, they spend all their time alone and in rural parts of the state. So, Jacob, what kind of things you think we could get into today?
Well, this time of year, my primary goal during deer season is to check hunters in the field, but you just never know what's going to happen. My phone's ringing constantly this time of year, and it could be anything from a simple regulation question or somebody that has a trespasser on their property that I need to go take care of. And also work very closely with my county, and if they have a serious call like a violent domestic or some sort of manhunt, I try to help them out as much as I can. And then also something simple like somebody getting turned around in the woods, we go and try to help them out. And you just never know what's going to happen.
Well, we're very thankful for you, Jacob, and all your fellow officers. A wildlife department that's prepared for anything you could possibly dream of. Just another reason to love Oklahoma and the adventures that await you.
My name is Smokey Solis, and I'm 27 years old. I didn't grow up deer hunting, and I didn't have any guidance on big game. I just never had anyone to teach me how. Until recently. This is my story of how I became a deer hunter.
My interest for deer hunting really started basically working with the wildlife department or at the wildlife department. And it just grew because I started in September of 2020. And then, that's right before deer season starts. So I was just like engulfed in it really quickly.
Deer hunting came up and he started asking a whole lot of questions. He hadn't ever experienced any kind of big game hunting before.
Todd deer hunts. So I was able to ask him about, patterns of deer, what they do, when they come out, when they're not there, just everything about deer. And honestly, I kind of felt bad for how many questions I was asking him because it was a lot.
Well, usually when somebody starts asking questions about hunting, I can tell if they're trying to just make small talk and be conversational or if they're really genuinely, really intrigued and interested. And I could definitely tell that Smokey was definitely really intrigued about trying to give big game hunting a try.
I don't remember the exact date, but I remember the time that we were in the office and I believe everyone was getting ready to leave for the day, but he was just like, well, let's make this happen. Like, we can make it happen and let's do it. And I just remember I was like a little bit speechless. I was like, okay, like, yeah, let's do it.
There's the man himself, Todd.
How are you, buddy?
Good, how are you?
Good. You ready for today?
Oh yeah, I'm ready.
Me too.
Ready to learn something.
I'm going to actually put you to work a little bit.
I'm in for it.
Okay.
Let's go.
All right, we got several things to take care of.
Okay.
I think that too often when we as mentors think about taking someone new hunting, we think about just that kill shot and getting them in front of a deer and making that opportunity happen for them. And that's important, but I also feel like it's just as important to give that person a much broader sense of what hunting is.
We got everything?
Yeah.
All right.
Exactly.
Let's hit the road. Head up there.
We went out not even to hunt one day and just give him a taste of what it's like to fill a feeder, look at deer sign, trim out shooting lanes, look at different blinds that I had set up ahead of time. You'll go around that, under that notch, and then up to this. There's just so much more to any hunting experience, in my opinion, than pulling the trigger. And if you don't start somebody out early enough to experience all those different things, I really feel like you're cheating them. And some of those things are the preparation of a spot and trying to conceptualize where deer might come in from. the whole idea of prepping a blind before you get there and making it suitable to hunt out of. And then there's the whole other aspect of just sharing that hunt with other people.
I'm excited. I'm really excited. I mean, I can imagine myself right now trying to find where the deer are coming through and just looking through the scope, you know? I don't even know what that feeling's like, but I can imagine all the excitement I can feel.
I've been doing it all my life.
I just, as a person, I really want to know everything that there has to do with what I'm about to do.
But a rub is where they'll use their antlers and rub up and down on a tree trunk. There's a gland on their forehead called an orbital gland.
I need to know the when, why, how, and the ins and outs of what the process is. So it was really important to me that Todd took me out and taught me what we're doing and why we're doing it.
Deer camp is an essential part of my experience every year, and I wanted Smokey to be able to get a taste of all of that.
I don't know if it is better or not, but food at a deer camp always seems to taste better.
With good company too.
Okay, this is it.
Yeah.
You got everything.
I think so.
Okay. Got the gun.
Yeah.
The ammo, your license in orange.
Yeah.
Everything else is extra.
Yeah. Let's go.
All right.
My nerves were there, obviously, for my first hunt, and just the process of walking through the dark to the blind and getting set up and having to be quiet was just a completely new experience, really.
Is a little bit lower over there.
Okay.
So you might get ready and anticipate a shot after that third cedar tree.
Okay.
Let's let her come a little bit more. That's a quartering two shot.
Is that the one I would shoot?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that one's totally fine.
Should I wait for the others?
I think that's a full adult doe.
Okay, right in front of the cedar.
The one right in front of the cedar, we're not gonna shoot right yet because the grass is too tall.
Should I put my scope on this one in front or wait for the others?
I think you should follow on this first one right here. If it comes another 10 yards.
Yeah.
across the creek there. If you go behind the cedar and come out on the right side, the grass is lower out there too.
Okay.
So move there to anticipate a shot. Yeah, one is coming. One is coming out right there. There's one behind it.
She's in the tall grass now.
Oh, man. Gosh. Okay, they're going back around that far left cedar again. Okay.
Yeah, I can see him, but the grass is too tall.
There's just too much grass.
Yeah.
No. Oh, goodness, that's a heartbreaker. I'm sorry.
That's all right.
We're right there, but it just...
I'd rather have a good shot.
Well, that's important. I mean, I respect that. Not rushing a shot or feeling like you just got to take a shot. If you don't have the shot, just don't take it.
Yeah.
Don't force it. Oh, gosh.
Yeah, so... It just seemed like everything happened pretty quickly, especially when the deer started to come out. And I would have a few opportunities to maybe take a shot, but a lot of those opportunities went away quickly. And I'm the type of hunter that will not take the shot if it's not going to be a good shot.
Oh, right there, right there, right there, right there, right in front of us, 10 yards. Oh my gosh, where did she come from? What is up with that deer? That thing is running all over the place.
This is crazy.
Holy crap. Where did she go?
I don't know. She ran like right.
She was 10 yards right there. What in the world?
All I saw was just a blur.
When I looked up and I just saw ears, and then I raised up higher, I could see her, and she was right there.
I guess we need to pay attention better.
How does a deer out in the wide open like that just sneak up on us and get 10 yards away?
I don't know. Yeah, I mean it's important to me to get a good shot, you know? I want to make sure to respect that animal in every way possible, and, you know, I'd do it a disservice if I took a shot that wasn't right. So I want to make sure I get on target correctly and have a clear view, because I respect that animal.
Disappointed I didn't get a deer, but I'm pretty optimistic. Just didn't get a good shot. And I mean, it'll just make it more special when I actually get the chance to pull the trigger and harvest a doe or a buck or whatever I get to shoot. So I'm gonna stay optimistic, and I'm excited for the next day I get to go.
We came very close many times, but we, in the end, just couldn't get it together. Regardless though, Smokey got a real genuine taste of what deer hunting is all about, and definitely whetted his appetite, and he was ready for the next year.
year went by and I was ready as all get out to go again and I guess redeem myself from last year.
Oh my gosh, you did it. Really?
So it was a huge satisfaction to be able to shoot that deer and just bring it full circle. Not only that I got to be out there with Todd, but also the satisfaction of knowing that I was able to put food in the freezer. It wasn't easy, that's for sure, but this is huge satisfaction.
There she is right there.
Oh. Oh man. A little bit farther than I thought, but.
Oh. Yeah, that's farther than I thought it was too.
Oh, Smokey. Oh gosh, I'm so proud of you. You did it.
Thank you.
The reason why I deer hunt is because I want to put food on my table. It's a huge satisfaction to know that I can go out and provide for my family and put a deer in the freezer or really put anything in the freezer. And I don't have to go to the grocery store. I don't have to rely on what's stocked on a shelf. Not only do I enjoy being out there in the wild, but there's just something peaceful about knowing that that's where I can get my food. I shot my first deer and just wanted to progress some more. Actually, my wife was the one that suggested that I buy a bow. So she told me, hey, you should get a bow because your season is way longer. You can shoot more deer. And so that's what I did. Hopefully I'll get another doe this year, but my first archery doe. And I'm ready to keep progressing into this. Don't be afraid to get out of your comfort zone. It's okay to ask questions, read the regulations, watch YouTube videos, talk to a game warden, learn as much as you can about whatever kind of game that you want to hunt, and it'll be very beneficial. And one of those people that you talk to might be the person that goes, hey, let's go, I'll take you. And they can become your mentor.
When I get out in the woods, it's like everything fades away. And there is calm and peacefulness, and it just gives me a break from all of the hustle and bustle that I have to deal with in town. I didn't grow up hunting. My husband introduced me back in 2012, and I went for the first time, I went black powder hunting, and ever since then I've been absolutely obsessed with hunting. It doesn't matter what comes out of the woods, whether it's a great big buck, a little fawn, or a doe, or yeah, sometimes even a squirrel can get me, my heart starts pounding. And it's so cool to be that close with a wild animal, and I have a lot of respect for that. We're guests in their home, and it's really spectacular getting to be a part of that, and I just wish everybody could have that experience. On those early morning hunts, going into the woods, I won't lie, sometimes I'm a little nervous when I'm walking in by myself. Climbing up into my stand, getting all set up in the quiet of the early morning before the sun even comes up is peaceful. And then people say it all the time, but I'm just gonna say it. I mean, you get to watch the woods wake up. You get to hear the woods wake up. You know, as soon as you start hearing birds chirping, that's kind of when the excitement starts building. We don't always have successful hunts, but I can promise you that I always take something away when I leave the woods. Whether it's a lesson of something that I did wrong or a memory that I have with my husband or my family or my friends forever.
The endangered whooping crane, one of North America's rarest birds, migrates to Oklahoma twice a year, giving birdwatchers and other wildlife enthusiasts a chance to see a species that narrowly escaped extinction in the early 1900s. Whooping cranes are large white birds that have long legs and necks. They have red crowns and facial patches and contrasting black wingtips that are only seen in flight. The cranes that move through Oklahoma are part of the Aransas wood buffalo population, the only remaining wild population. They winter in coastal Texas at Aransas National Wildlife Refuge and nest in Alberta, Canada at Wood Buffalo National Park. This 2,500-mile one-way flight may take as many as 50 days in the fall, but experienced pairs may make the return trip in the spring in as little as 10 days. Whooping cranes typically migrate in small numbers or in family groups, but those birds will often join large flocks of sandhill cranes. In Oklahoma, the birds will stop over at wetlands, lakes, and agricultural fields to feed and rest before continuing their migration. For more information on Oklahoma's incredibly diverse species, check out our many resources at wildlifedepartment.com. There you can browse field guides, share wildlife sightings, and subscribe to The Wild Side, our monthly e-newsletter dedicated to non-game conservation efforts.
Well, we hope today's stories remind you that Oklahoma is a perfect state to explore. So however you choose to enjoy our state's incredible natural world, remember, your adventure starts with Outdoor Oklahoma. Where's the siren? Can I push the siren?
Just don't hit that one right there.
Outdoor Oklahoma is produced by the Oklahoma Department of Wildlife Conservation and is proud to serve and be funded entirely by sportsmen and women and outdoor enthusiasts who love and appreciate all things wild in the great state of Oklahoma.